Our parsha contains within it the great tragedy of the golden calf. The Torah tells how 3 months after leaving Egypt and a mere 40 days after receiving the Torah at Har Sinai, the Jewish people created an idol and they go and they worship it. And having miscalculated the date of Moshe's promised return from the mountain, the Jewish people thought that their leader had died, and so they decide to replace him, and with the help of Aaron, they form a golden calf and go on to worship it. And among the repercussions of this enormous tragedy is the substitution of the Bechorim, the firstborn of the tribe of Levi, as those that would ultimately serve in the Beit HaMikdash. And as we know, when we fast forward to Parshat Korach, the firstborns, they harbor intense feelings of resentment over their loss of this right. And generally speaking, the reason most often given as to why the Levim, the Levites, why they received this honor, it relates to their refraining from participating in the sin of the golden calf. But the truth is, if we look carefully in the Torah, and in particular, if we look all the way at the bracha that Moshe gives to Bnei Levi prior to his death at the end of Sefer Devarim, we see Moshe actually allude to a bit of a different reason. The pasuk reads there in Devarim that Ha'omer le'aviv limo lo ritiv, a person says to of his father and his mother, he says, I consider them not, quote unquote. And Rashi explains based on the Medrash that this pasuk is referring to the sin of the golden calf of Chet Ha'egel. You see, upon Moshe's descent from Har Sinai, he goes and sees the people's crimes. And in that moment, he declares, Mi l'Hashem Eli, whoever is for Hashem, for God, please come here. And the tribe of Levi who gather round, and Moshe orders them to execute the perpetrators of the sin. And this is what he alludes to. And when we think about who should get to serve in the Beis HaMikdash, what is it about these specific actions that render the tribe of Levi so worthy of serving? What is it that's so significant in what they did to come help Moshe in executing all of these sinners? And so the Chafetz Chaim suggests that when it comes to the Beis HaMikdash, and in particular the merit of the person serving in the temple itself, such a responsibility can only be reserved for those who answer the call in times of need. Throughout a person's life, the Chafetz Chaim says, a person who always hears a silent call of Mi l'Hashem Eli, whoever's for Hashem, come here. Situations will arise requiring proactive involvement or selfless devotion. And most people would rather be passive, they would rather be idle than to hurry to help, or for example, to hurry and help Moshe in response to the call. And yet, however, some zealously drop everything they're doing to rush and to act. Those are the real heroes. And it's only these such people that earn the right of performing the sacred service in the Beis HaMikdash. And this simple, albeit meaningful idea can actually be seen in one other place as well. There's a famous machlokas between Rashi and the Ramban about whether the order of events given in the Torah are listed in chronological order or not. And Rashi teaches that Ein Mukdam U'Mukhar b'Torah, that there is no chronological order, and therefore explains that the incident of the golden calf happened a considerable amount of time before the commandment regarding the building of the Beis HaMikdash. You see, even though the command regarding the Mikdash appears in previous week's Parshiot, and the sin of the golden calf comes in our Parsha this week, Rashi argues that there is no chronology in the Torah. And so according to him, one needs to simply ask a question of why, according to Rashi, does the Torah in fact record our Parshiot out of order, out of chronological order? Why does it happen in this way and in this order, the way that we read it each and every year? And so some suggest that the Torah interrupts the narrative of the golden calf and purposefully juxtaposes the commandment of the Mishkan, which takes place at the beginning of Parshat Truma, specifically following the Jewish people's declaration of Na'aseh v'Nishma at the end of the previous Parsha of Mishpatim. And this, perhaps we can suggest, teaches us that resolute declarations and promises like Na'aseh v'Nishma, they mean very little if you don't follow up with concrete action. Good intentions, emotional identification with an important cause is very important, but it's of far less significance than active involvement. And so therefore the Torah follows the Jewish people's heroic proclamation of Na'aseh v'Nishma with the commandment to build the Mishkan before continuing with the story of Chet Ha'egel. And the Mikdash, the spiritual backbone of the Jewish people, it is built by those who generously give of their time and their resources for the cause of building and doing. It's not for those who sit on the sideline or just shout encouraging words, but rather those who get up and do. Those are the heroes worthy of building the Mikdash. And for the same reason, it's the Levim who run the Beit HaMikdash after demonstrating that same zeal and fervor in this most critical and tragic moment in our nation's history. And friends, as we're approaching the one-year mark on the calendar in this most tragic and difficult time period, as we have lived through unimaginable challenges and stress, we look around and we see and we cherish and we celebrate the heroes, the men and women, the first responders, the volunteers, the lay leaders, the members of our community who heard the call to action of Mi LaHashem Eli, who stepped up in the most holy of ways to selflessly support those in need this past year. And we pray that the end is near and that God continues to give all of us the strength for what lies ahead, and that we should also all be able to answer this silent call to help in times of need of Mi LaHashem Eli. Shabbat Shalom.